We're back again, Dr Rick Strassman, and this time round we're going to be talking, Dr Strassman will be answering questions more about DMT and the connection between DMT and prophecy as described in the Hebrew Bible. Before we get started, I'll just say that the language we use for exploring these topics is important, and I would like to invite you, Dr. Strassman, to correct me if I erroneously use terms, and you're welcome to suggest alternative terminology for me to use. For instance, the difference between a generic term, psychedelic, and the more legal medical term, hallucinogenic, is an important one, and it's a small semantic differences like that that can unravel the thread of exposition. The objects of these types of lines of inquiry can be indistinct and mysterious and even illusory. And therefore, it's my opinion that to try and insist on rational clarity can kind of be futile. And I think it suffices to say that we will do our best. And I'd like to invite any live viewers to contribute any questions they have for Dr. Strassman, and we'll try to include them. So I just wanted to ask a couple of questions that I forgot to ask last time, actually. And one of them was, I would like to ask you who your role models were in your school and college years. When you were growing up, who did you look up to?
Role models. Well, I had some very inspiring teachers during my public school years. A couple come to mind. I think the ones that were most inspiring were the ones that were most encouraging. For example, in junior high school, middle school, I had a science teacher who wrote in my annual that year, that he was expecting to, see my name on, scientific papers at some point in the future. And I was only 12 or 13 years old at the time. And I thought, that was quite a nice thing for him to say. In 12th grade, my last year of high school, I had a inspiring English teacher who really encouraged me to just, write what I thought, to just, to take whatever ideas I might have and, put them on paper. So they were encouraging, inspiring, somewhat inspiring. As far as inspiration, who did I want to, be like? Well, in college, I really liked Aldous Huxley. I wanted to, be like him, to write in an eloquent manner, to combine, science, philosophy, and religion. So he was a real, role model, or, somebody whose station I wished to attain to at some point. I was maybe 20, 21 years old at that time. I used to run, track in high school, and it was when, Bob Hayes was kind of the world's fastest human, and I sprinted in high school, so I emulated Bob Hayes. I wanted to be as fast as he was. Of course, I was only, I would have come in 20 yards behind him in any race, or 20 meters, but one could hope. There is a, fictional character who was the, subject of a number of books named Doc Savage. And those books came out in the, 50s and the 60s. Sherlock Holmes, Superman, engineering type. And I just read all of his books. I just really, you know, loved the you know, books about, you know, Doc Savage. And I guess in, you know, some ways I admired him, wanted to, you know, be like him if it were at all possible. And I read all the James Bond books, too, when I was around 13. So I guess there was a little bit of wanting to be an ultra-suave, international, globe-trotting spy who, you know, saved the day. You know, so those kind of characters, both, you know, real and unreal.
So my next question is going to be about the first wave of MT research in the 1950s. And I believe that the researchers were trying to find out if psychedelic, if the states that users of psychedelic drugs found themselves in were like psychotic states. And so I was wondering if you know if the researchers did conclude that at that time that DMT was a psychomimetic, because I'm wondering how DMT managed to get caught up in the stigmatization of psychedelics when it's so unique in its effect.
Yeah. Well, perhaps, you know, so perhaps before I answer that question, or we start, you know, discussing that, we can return to some of the comments you made in your introductory remarks about what, you know, to call these drugs. Do you call them, you know, hallucinogens, or, you know, do you call them psychedelics? And I agree that what we, you know, call these, you know, substances is very important, you know, nomenclature. Yeah, the most common, you know, two terms, or the ones that have been most common, are hallucinogenic and, you know, psychedelic. You know, psychedelic means mind manifesting or mind disclosing. And, you know, hallucinogenic is a little more specific. It refers, you know, to the hallucinations, which aren't, you know, always the case. I mean, people, you know, do not, you know, always experience, you know, visions or, you know, voices or things like that. And also, I think, you know, hallucination is kind of a loaded term because it refers to, you know, something imaginary that isn't really there. But still, it is the most commonly used term in the, you know, medical and the legal literature. Although I think, you know, that is, you know, changing. If you, you know, look at articles about these, you know, substances, increasingly people are using the word psychedelic. And I think, you know, psychedelic is the most generic because it can describe an experience where you have, you know, visions and you experience voices, or your thinking is disturbed, or your thinking is unaffected, where you're happy, or you're sad, or you're not, you know, feeling anything at all. You know, so it is disclosing what's going on in the mind. You know, so I think because it's the most generic and the most all-encompassing, it's the most useful. You know, because if anything is, you know, the hallmark of the effects of these drugs, it's, it is, you know, the variability of the experience. Quite a bit can happen, or, you know, nothing at all could happen. A more, you know, well, there's a newer term which is called entheogen, which means, you know, generating, you know, the divine from within. But, you know, that's kind of a loaded term because it assumes, you know, that divinity is an internal experience, you know, rather than an experience of, you know, something from the outside. And it also bespeaks a, you know, belief in spirituality or the spiritual, you know, world. And, you know, not everybody, you know, holds that belief. And that kind of experience may not be, you know, something that, you know, somebody is interested in who might otherwise be able to benefit from taking a, you know, psychedelic drug. You know, you could be an atheist and you wouldn't want to, for example, you know, take a substance that's going to generate spirituality or contact with, you know, God, you know, Theos, you know, the divine. You know, so I think it closes off both, you know, the possibilities and the people who might, you know, potentially, you know, benefit from taking these, you know, substances in the right setting. You know, other terms for these compounds are, you know, things like, you know, psychotomimetic, you know, which you mentioned early on. You know, so that, you know, came about as a result of, you know, people, you know, thinking, you know, that the experiences, you know, resemble those of naturally occurring psychosis. And, you know, that, you know, term is still used in the European literature, the Swiss and the German literature, you know, continues, you know, to use that term, you know, because these, you know, substances are being used in, you know, research exploring, you know, the biology of, you know, psychosis. But of all of the, you know, terms, I, you know, think the most, you know, generic and applicable is, you know, psychedelic. Yeah, you know, so, you know, back in the day, yeah, you know, people were quite interested in, you know, the relationship between the psychedelics and psychosis. And, you know, it was kind of the meme that was going through psychiatry at the time. You know, people had, you know, just, you know, discovered serotonin in the brain, the first, you know, neurotransmitter. You know, people also at around that time, you know, discovered the antipsychotic effects of Thorazine or chlorpromazine, and also LSD, and it was also the time of discovery of LSD. You know, so, you know, that, you know, so people were starting to, you know, make a connection, you know, between, you know, substances in the brain, you know, substances that you could take, and specific, you know, kinds of, you know, psychopathology. And, you know, the most florid, you know, psychopathology is, you know, psychosis. You know, so, you know, early on, you know, people were giving LSD, you know, to normal volunteers and, you know, comparing descriptions of those states with descriptions of naturally occurring psychosis. And, you know, hopefully, or, well, the hope was at the time, if, you know, LSD produced, you know, something like psychosis, and if you could find an compound, you know, like LSD in the human body, which was responsible for naturally occurring, you know, psychotic experiences, you know, then if you could blockade the responses to LSD, you might be able to blockade the naturally occurring LSD-like substance, which might be responsible, you know, for psychotic states. You know, so that was a very, you know, fruitful area of research. And, you know, there were a couple of, so there were a, you know, couple of, you know, lines of investigation. You know, one was, you know, to compare, you know, the phenomenology of the, you know, psychedelic state and the phenomenology of the naturally occurring psychoses. You know, the conclusion, you know, was, you know, that there was some overlap. And as the description of, you know, psychosis became, you know, more refined, they spoke about things like, you know, positive symptoms and the negative symptoms. And, you know, the positive, you know, symptoms of, you know, psychosis were things like hallucinations, you know, thought disorder, confused thinking. You know, those were the most, you know, well, the most pronounced. You know, the negative symptoms were, you know, things like mental slowing, you know, loss of will, not being able to move very much, You know, so those were called, you know, the negative symptoms. You know, so the positive symptoms, oh, and, you know, paranoia is a positive symptom. And elevated mood, you know, like elation and, you know, mania is a positive symptoms. You know, if you have a, you know, flat affect, you're not very responsive, you know, to your environment, you know, those are called the negative symptoms. You know, so ultimately, the, you know, psychedelics were more, you know, seen to elicit the, you know, positive symptoms of psychosis. You know, so that was, you know, one avenue of investigation. The other, you know, was, you know, was along the lines of what I, you know, was describing with respect, you know, to exploring the possibility that there was a, you know, a, you know, that there was a, you know, naturally, you know, formed a compound in the human body with, you know, psychedelic properties. And, you know, so that's where the DMT story came in. And, you know, we can return to that in a minute. And, you know, so the last, you know, line of inquiry or of investigation was intended to improve empathy in psychiatrists and other mental health professionals, you know, by giving students or, you know, trainees or even, you know, people in established, you know, practice an experimental psychosis. You know, so they could relate, you know, to the experience of their patients who were experiencing, you know, psychotic states. You know, so they would know what it was like to be, you know, temporarily psychotic, and, you know, that would help them in their, you know, treatment and understanding of the mental experience of schizophrenics, for example. Yeah, you know, so those, and also, I guess, you know, finally, you know, they would give, you know, psychedelics, you know, to psychotic, you know, patients, you know, to ask, you know, the psychotic patients, you know, to compare the effects of a psychedelic with what happens when, you know, they were, you know, normally psychotic. You know, so if you gave, you know, DMT, you know, to somebody that was, you know, quietly psychotic, you know, they weren't in the midst of a florid exacerbation, and you would say, well, you know, how does, you know, this compare, you know, to what it's like when you're sick? You know, are the voices, you know, similar? Are the visions, you know, similar? Are the emotional reactions, you know, similar in response to being given DMT as compared to what occurs, you know, naturally, you know, when you're ill? You know, so those were, you know, kind of the studies or the, you know, lines of inquiry which were occurring, you know, during the first, you know, wave of psychedelic studies in humans.
I'm wondering what you would say the most urgent areas are for further DMT research.
The most urgent areas. Well, I think one thing that's important to do is to, you know, characterize the state better, or as you know, well as we can. You know, one of the drawbacks of the pure DMT state is that up until now, it's really only, you know, been available through smoking or the you know, parenteral administration, you know, either intravenously or intramuscularly as an injection. And if it's smoked or injected, it's quite brief. And there's just not enough, you know, time to really orient in that space and investigate it. You know, one might argue that ayahuasca is a prolonged oral DMT experience. And in a lot of ways it is, but still, it is difficult to, you know, tease apart, you know, what are the effects of DMT itself, what are the responses, you know, to the beta carbolines, you know, like harmine and, you know, harmaline, and, you know, what is, you know, the result of the combination of the two, you know, the beta carbolines and DMT. You know, so I think one thing that's important is to extend and prolong, you know, the DMT experience in order to explore it more carefully. And a few months ago, a colleague of mine from Japan, a British fellow named Andrew Gallimore, approached me about a mathematical model for the continuous infusion of a drug, which is based on the anesthesiology literature, where you have to keep people asleep and attain and maintain a steady state of an anesthetic drug. And he applied that to DMT, based on the half-life and metabolism data that we generated from the original DMT work. So that paper came out recently, and it's a description of how to calculate the amount of DMT necessary to put somebody in that state and to maintain them in it for as long as necessary, or for as long as desired. So hopefully somebody will pick up the challenge and do that experiment. Get people to a prolonged DMT state, where you can enter into it and drop out of it and interact and be interviewed, by the investigators to, characterize the state more carefully. Because even though, there are, quite a few, similarities between the DMT state and, that resulting, from other compounds like mushrooms, psilocybin, LSD, mescaline, DMT is unique in a, number of ways. There's no tolerance to its effects. It, causes, dissociation of the mind from the body quite consistently. The presence of, intelligences within that state is more often reported than is the case with the other drugs. And, most importantly, DMT is endogenous. It's, made in the human body. So I think even though there are, lots of, similarities between, DMT and other psychedelics, it is unique enough, that, characterizing it in a more, leisurely manner than is possible with the injected form or the smoked, form is important. Well, like, for example, establishing, contact, with the beings which are often reported in those states. Most of the time in, my studies, it was quite, difficult to establish a stable, communication, with those beings. The language wasn't quite shared. The anxiety was, too great on the part of the volunteers. And, by the time, communication was established, the effect started fading. So if, somebody could spend hours in that state, I think it would be easier to, see what is, possible with respect to establishing more stable kinds of interactions, with those beings. Also, what is, the nature of the state? Like, for example, there are all these spinning objects, often reported, or structures, or trees, or gems, or things like that. So if one was in that state for a long enough time, you could explore those buildings, what's in those buildings. You could approach, some of the vegetation there and, look at it more carefully, and you can handle it, or you could taste it, or you could, pull apart, the petals of the flowers. You could pick up a rock and, chip at it and, see what happens. And all those things aren't really possible when you're just, getting your bearings in that state. You're there for just a couple of minutes and then start coming down. And I think, once that state is, better characterized, I think, then we'll be able to determine, what it's good for. Is it going to be good for therapy? Is it going to be good for creativity? Are there things that we can, learn there that might help us, develop a clean, source of, limitless energy, those kinds of things, which we can't, really approach in a very concerted kind of manner right now.
So hours, I could imagine hours being spent under the influence of DMT. Of course, it's necessary to kind of come back to reality in order to take care of basic human needs, like perhaps eating, sleeping, washing, using the bathroom, that kind of thing. So, because I wonder just how many hours, based on what you've said, it's safe, but it's just a case of how long you can go until your human needs bring you back to Earth, sort of thing.
Right. Well, you'd start off slow and then build up, and, there would be, signals which would be established that the, volunteer would express if they got into trouble or they wanted to take a break or it was too much or they wanted to increase the experience. So in, my studies, people were pretty incapacitated for, maybe 15 or 20 minutes. So if you were to keep, somebody in that state with that continuous infusion model, I suppose you would, begin with, like a half hour and then you would bring them out of it. And if everything seemed good, you would then, put them in that state for an hour. And, just kind of, build up by, 30-minute increments, let's say. When I was, doing these studies, we performed a repeated, dosing experiment where we gave people a big dose of DMT, four times in the space of a morning. Every half hour, we gave them a, full injection. People, would be in that state for 15, 20 minutes. They'd come out of it and, we would talk, they'd have a sip of water if need be and, get, ready for the next, dose. And, that worked out pretty well. It was a, 2-hour experience, but it was up and down. So I think in the future, if you could keep, people in at least a, 2-hour state, it wouldn't be much trouble. And, people take ayahuasca and they're in a, pretty altered state for, 4 hours or so without any, problems. And, clearly, one of the advantages of intravenous DMT is it's cleared really quickly, like just within the space of minutes. So if, somebody wanted, to take a break, you stop the infusion and they'd be able to, walk around the room in, 10 minutes or so. So it's quite handy that way.
Having watched DMT and the Spirit Molecule, the documentary, which is currently available on Netflix, it seems almost as if, and please feel free to correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems that at that time you felt some shame about the way that the trials had been. And if I remember, you say that you wanted to, if you bring people to these experiences, that you wanted to be able to you felt that you needed to understand the state in a more complete way, and I want to know, do you feel shame about, are you ashamed of the trials, and would you be a part of further trials?
Well, I'm not, sure if I would use the word, shame, although I might use the word, guilty, but I put that in quotes because, guilt assumes some responsibility or some, knowledge that you're doing, something wrong. At least, a particular, form of guilt. I suppose guilt that, you know, returns upon, you know, somebody, you know, fully, requires you knowing the difference between, you know, right and wrong, and then, you know, going ahead and doing wrong anyway. I don't think, you know, that was the case, that I knew I was doing something wrong and was doing it anyway. And I don't feel ashamed, like I'm a bad person for having done those studies. You know, I think I was, you know, kind of under the impression that I knew more about the DMT world than I really did. And once it became clear to me that I really didn't quite know what was going on, then I started feeling like, is this really the best thing for me and for the volunteers? And as the studies progressed, that feeling became even stronger, which was, you know, some of the, you know, some of the reasons which, you know, for when I stopped the project when I did. No, I'm really, you know, glad I did the study. And, you know, if you ask the volunteers, I would say, you know, almost, you know, uniformly, you know, they're glad to have participated. You know, so I was, you know, keeping that to myself, like I really had no idea what I was doing kind of thoughts, like I don't have any idea what I'm doing, but I'll keep that to myself and we'll, you know, forge ahead and, you know, hopefully I'll, you know, figure it out, or my volunteers will help me figure it out. You know, so, yeah. And at a certain point I thought, well, okay, I've learned as much as I need to, and these volunteers have, you know, had, you know, some really tremendous and remarkable experiences. So, I thought, well, it's, you know, time to stop and, you know, let me, stand back and, you know, and, you know, think about what happened, you know, reappraise it, you know, try to understand, you know, develop, you know, some models, you know, through which it made more sense. You know, so the second part of your question, you know, would I do it again or would I get involved in research again? You know, up until maybe the last few months, I would just say not really, because there's plenty of good research being done by plenty of good people in the field. You know, but it is pretty striking that, you know, nobody has really, you know, picked up the... Well, the DMT ball, you know, there was a one German study that came out in, you know, 2005, you know, where they compared, you know, DMT with ketamine in a, you know, psychotomimetic, you know, model. You know, DMT produces, you know, positive symptoms of schizophrenia, and, you know, ketamine produced, you know, negative symptoms of schizophrenia. You know, so that's been it with respect to pure DMT studies, you know, since mine, you know, finished up in 1995. and this, you know, paper that Andrew Gallimore and I put together on the continuous infusion protocol, you know, it's a great opportunity to re-explore the DMT state, which most people in the scientific community don't seem especially eager to do. So, you know, it's been 21 years since I've, you know, finished my study. One DMT paper has come out, you know, since then. So, you know, obviously it's a vacuum, or it's a niche, or it's a, you know, gap, or a, you know, void that still needs to be, you know, filled. So, you know, if, you know, the opportunity arose, if, you know, for example, you know, some department of, you know, psychiatry approached me and said, you know, we would, you know, really, you know, like to do this continuous infusion study, would you come on board and help us design it and implement it? I would, you know, probably agree to do it.
Certainly, gaining access to DMT in the street or in the concrete jungle is when you acquire some DMT, whoever's given it to you just sort of pats you on the back and sends you on your way. And I know that you do have shamanic settings out in the jungles and places like that, but in the cities and in the kind of the Western world, for psychonauts or experimenters to gain access to these types of to DMT, it's extremely difficult, as you know, under prohibition. It's very difficult to get access to something which you can trust as being carefully made and pure. And it was quite touching to me to see some of your patients, if that's the right word for them, and to see yourself recount the degree of care and the degree of just carefulness that the whole thing was conducted under, and to see that still wasn't quite enough for you, and was, to me, it was touching. But so I wanted to ask you, how should people, in your opinion, people who are going to anyway, how should they go about gaining access to and using DMT, and what kind of DMT is kind of the safest to look for?
Well, there's two, you know, ways to get DMT. You know, one is to extract it from plants that contain it. And, you know, the other is to, you know, synthesize it from scratch in a laboratory. And, you know, you can always, you know, debate, well, if it's made in a lab, is it as, you know, good as what's extracted from plants? But I think, you know, generally, you know, DMT is DMT. It's like, you know, vitamin C is vitamin C. You get it from an orange or you make it in a lab. If it's 100%, you know, vitamin C, it's 100%, you know, vitamin C. If you've, you know, cleaned off all of, you know, the other accompanying compounds that you might be having extracted from fruit, if it's just pure vitamin C, then it's, you know, the same, you know, chemical compound. You know, so if you're extracting DMT from plants, it could be as pure as what is made in a lab, if it's, you know, pure. Or, you know, could be, you know, contaminated with other, you know, substances, you know, from the extraction process or which are contained in the plants. And in the, you know, same way, if your, you know, chemist isn't that, you know, good and he's making it, or, you know, she's making it in a lab, you know, there can be also, you know, some contaminants. You know, so the most important thing is the purity. And if it's not pure, then, you know, what are the impurities that you, you know, might be getting? You know, it's quite, you know, difficult to make DMT from scratch, not because of the complicated nature of the, you know, synthesis, you know, but because the precursors or the ingredients are really closely monitored. You know, so in the U.S. anyway, if you're going to be buying the ingredients, you know, for DMT, those are monitored. Even though it's not a, you know, very, you know, complicated, you know, process to make it in the lab. You know, so what most people do is they extract it from plants. Up until recently, you could get those plants on the internet, but, you know, the government is catching on and, you know, making it more, you know, difficult, you know, to either import those plants or to, you know, sell them online. You know, the extraction's not difficult. I've never, you know, tried it, and I've, you know, really not looked that carefully into what the, you know, various extraction, you know, methods are, but on my understanding, anyway, that, you know, they're not especially, you know, technical, and, you know, don't require, you know, fancy chemicals or procedures. You know, so what is the, you know, the most appropriate, you know, way to take DMT? What's the best, you know, setting? Well, you know, first you have to establish your set, which is your state of mind and your state of body. And, you know, that has to be as optimal as, you know, possible. And I think optimal means, you know, that you're well educated about what you're about to undergo, and that you're, you know, prepared, you know, psychologically, spiritually. You've worked out your intent, you've worked out, you know, the, you know, people that you're going to be doing it with, you have plans for what to do if things go wrong. You know what the state is like, and you've got questions for it, or you have, you know, goals or tasks at hand that you've worked out beforehand, and you know, methodologies for, you know, for manifesting, you know, that intent in the state itself. You know, those kinds of things. You know, that you're, you know, psychologically healthy. You've, you know, taken care of your bills. You're prepared to die in, you know, some ways. Well, in my study, I only coached, people to a minimal degree. We didn't have incense or, bells or mantras or yoga postures, or I didn't hold people's hands, necessarily anyway. I just, told people two things. It's really fast, and you may think that you've died. And if you do think you've died, you have, two ways of dealing with that. One is, oh shit, I've died, and, get me out of here. Or the other is, okay, I've died. This is very interesting. What do I do next? What is this like? And you continue forward. And I also tell people, nobody's ever died from pure DMT, so it's unlikely, that you will. But if you have any, problems, we have a, crash cart out in the hall, and, the Code Blue team is ready if need be. Yeah, so those were, my only instructions. It's, fast, and you may think you've died, in which case you, have to deal with, that thought. I mean, other than that, I think you need to do your homework and, be prepared and, know what you're going to be getting into. That being said, I mean, there's any number of, ways or any, number of things that you can be, hoping for or, seeking in a, DMT experience. You might just be interested in pleasure. The visions can be, beautiful. The emotional responses can be ecstatic. So you just might be curious. You want the aesthetic experience. You also might be going into it for, creativity. You might have a scientific or, personal, problem, artistic problem, that you want to solve that you aren't able to, solve in the normal waking state. You might be in a conflicted, situation, that you don't want to, get some insight into. You might be interested in spiritual experiences, in which case you would bring your model, to the effect, is your belief that your spirituality is all generated from within, or do you see it as external to yourself, in which case your approach would differ. You might just want to listen to music, in which case you might want to do smaller doses, those kinds of things.
From what I've seen from your YouTube videos and from what I've heard of your appearances in other podcasts, it appears that you now believe firmly that there is a God and there is an external spirit realm. And I'm interested to know what pushed you over the edge from a sort of a soft neurotheology to now a theoneurology, if you can bring it down to just one experience or a group of experiences that were what changed you. You changed your mind.
Well, I guess there were a few things. It wasn't like a flash. It was pretty, gradual evolution. It did just, happen like overnight. It took years, actually, to, go from, this is your brain on drugs to, this is, God communicating with you through your brain. It took years, 10, 15 years probably, of, mulling over both, my findings and, sifting through, models for understanding those findings. One of the most important elements from the volunteers' reports were their conviction that they were being, shown things, that it was the, revelation of a freestanding external reality, as opposed to a hallucination or a dream or a drug effect. The three models I had brought to bear on the reality bases of the DMT state all proposed that the DMT state was fundamentally unreal. This is your brain on drugs, model, psychoanalytic model, which would understand, the visions and, the voices as, symbolic representations of the unconscious, or even the Zen model, which looked at anything other than the state of emptiness as basically mind brain detritus, which was being shed on the way towards that formless empty state of enlightenment. So all three of those models that I had brought to the research proposed that the states were unreal, or what the individual was apprehending, was perceiving, was unreal. And so that approach, or that attitude towards people's stories, couldn't help but leak through in my interactions with them, and they felt that I really wasn't believing them at a basic essential level. And as a result, people were closing off some from the full disclosure of what they had just undergone. So at a certain point, I kind of decided to do a thought experiment, and and to take at face value that what they were apprehending in that state was something completely independent of them. It was like an invisible world which all of a sudden became visible, and it was not being generated in their brain, but as a result of the DMT, their consciousness was now able to perceive it. That kind of smoothed the way for people to be more comfortable with full disclosure of what they were undergoing. And I figured, well, after my studies are done, I can go back to the drawing board and figure out how that could be the case. So that was one strong impetus to have me begin to look at the reality bases of the DMT world. The other was how the DMT state didn't seem like what I was expecting, or what the volunteers were expecting. It seemed to be irregardless, or regardless of my expectations and the volunteers' expectations. We were all expecting the formless enlightenment state. I mean, I was a Buddhist, pretty hardcore at the time. Most of the volunteers were into practicing some kind of meditation. So all of us were expecting a like an empty, formless, content-free, image-free, thought-free, unitive experience. And it was completely the opposite. Maybe one volunteer out of nearly 60 had that kind of white light experience, and even then, it was yellow. It wasn't even white. I started to think, well, this isn't like the enlightenment state. It's like something else, but I'm not sure what it's like. So those were the two main things. I suppose also, although this was more subtle, was the inkling of a God-like experience lurking behind the, you know, DMT state, although, you know, that only became clear or, you know, became apparent to me in, you know, the course of, you know, writing my, you know, new book on, you know, DMT and the prophetic experience, you know, when I was actually, you know, looking, you know, for reports in my volunteers about, you know, something like God or God-like.
So, it's, neither of us would claim to be fully fledged biblical scholars, but in our inquiries, we're about to draw some conclusions. But rather, the story is to be an allegory of cosmological activity, which has been done before, previous pagan myths. What's your feeling on whether or not the Bible is actually a historical record, and how important is it to establish that the Bible is or isn't a historical record when you are talking in terms of DMT and the soul of prophecy?
The
message of prophecy.
Yeah, it might be helpful to describe, you know, my, you know, path from, you know, Zen brain chemistry and, you know, psychoanalytic psychology, you know, to the Hebrew Bible, you know, and, you know, then we can, you know, launch into, you know, what is the Hebrew Bible and, you know, how do you understand it or, you know, how do I understand it? Well, you know, so after I completed my studies, I started to, you know, look for, you know, models which could, you know, possibly explain how DMT could be providing access to externally real, objective, you know, levels of reality, which otherwise, you know, weren't visible. You know, so I started, you know, looking at, you know, notions of dark matter and, you know, parallel universes, which I think in, you know, some ways are useful mechanistic, you know, constructs in the, you know, sense, you know, that perhaps, you know, DMT through its, you know, modifying brain chemistry is also, you know, modifying, you know, the receiving characteristics of the mind-brain complex, and you know, provides access to, you know, levels of reality which aren't, you know, normally available or, you know, visible. You know, like a machine. You know, like a tool. You know, like a telescope or a microscope. You know, you're not able to see bacteria, you know, viruses. You know, those kinds of things. You know, with the unaided eye. You know, but you can, you know, with a microscope, and you're not able to, you know, see stars and, you know, planets, you know, with the unaided eye, you know, but you can with a telescope. And, you know, the brain is a way more complicated instrument than any of, you know, those machines, you know, so it isn't incomprehensible or, you know, to imagine that, you know, chemically, you know, that you're able, you know, to modify your senses, you know, capability of, you know, perceiving things, you know, which are already there all around us all the time, but just, you know, need some kind of, you know, modification of our sensory apparatus. You know, obviously, though, it isn't consensual. You know, like anybody could look through a microscope and, you know, see the same thing, or look through a telescope. And you're not able to, at least at this point, you know, provide that kind of, you know, consensual validation, you know, with the DMT state. Even though, if you do think about it, everybody reports, you know, more or less, you know, the same thing on DMT. Like everybody, you know, reports, you know, that their dreams are, you know, more or less, you know, like other people's dreams. You know, so there seems to be a dream state, which is, you know, subjectively objective. You know, everybody reports it. You know, so I think, you know, that goes, you know, for something. And, you know, with the DMT state, everybody or you know, most everybody, you know, reports a fairly similar, kind of landscape. So I was, thinking about, okay, if DMT can allow us, to perceive, the contents of dark matter, the contents of parallel universes. If that's the case, then that raises a number of other questions. For example, why is the brain so configured, and why does DMT do that? Why doesn't DMT make us grow an extra nose, for example? Instead, it seems to routinely, reliably provide access to these relatively uniformly described states. And also, it didn't really quite answer the issue of the the message content of these states. You could mechanistically perhaps describe how DMT could provide access to these states, but it really didn't point to any to any relevance of entering into that state other than describing its existence. And this kind of returns to one of the things that was striking in the reports of my DMT volunteers, is that other than they're describing the nature of the DMT world, they didn't really return with all that much information. The message of the DMT state didn't seem anywhere near as profound as the nature of the DMT state. People might return with some psychological insights regarding their personality or their character. They might come to some creative discoveries or breakthroughs of a kind of mild nature, to be honest. But overall, the message content, the information that people returned with from the DM state, the DMT state, wasn't anywhere nearly as profound as their extremely detailed descriptions of what the perceptual phenomenological character of the experience was. So even if somebody's entering into the contents of dark matter, or being able to perceive it, it didn't really prove that much, or it wasn't all that useful. So I began thinking, well, if so, then so what? So what that we can enter into these states? What are they good for? Are we any smarter, wiser, kinder, more compassionate? So then I started to shift with respect to my default position. This was around the time that my Zen community and I parted ways. Like I completed my studies in 1995. Then the monastery and I kind of got into I guess a scuffle over whether I could be talking about the relationship between Buddhist practice and the psychedelic drug state. So we kind of went back and forth for maybe 6 months, and things ended up the end of 96 or so. So that then freed me up to study, in a way, other traditions. So I was, wandering through a, New Age bookstore in Port Townsend, Washington, where I was living at the time. And it was interesting. There was huge amounts of, books on, on, Buddhism and on, Hinduism, like, row after row after row. And I was thinking, I've just had it with the East, with the East, with Eastern religious, practices, philosophy and whatnot. So I walked upstairs, hoping to, find something out. To find something else. There was a cult, and there was, Rosicrucians and, Theosophists and, pagans and. And, there was a small, section on, Judaism. Like, it couldn't have been, more than 18 inches. So I said, oh, I'm Jewish. I wonder if there's anything here. And I came across this small book called The Kabbalah of Envy, by a Brazilian rabbi named, whose name was Bonder, Nilton Bonder, B-O-N-D-E-R. And it was ironic because it was, published by Shambhala, which is a big Buddhist press in Colorado. But still, it was a pretty cover, turquoise blue, and I'm from New Mexico, and we like turquoise down here. And I opened it up, and it was a small book, 150, 200 pages, and I was impressed with the clarity of his thinking and the clarity of his writing. So I, bought the book and went home and I read it, and I was, really impressed with the spiritual approach, to relationships, to interactions. It, seemed, like the Jewish model, or at least the one that he was, presenting, was interactive and relational. And instead of beginning with formless enlightenment, the empty state, and things kind of devolving from there, he began with a minute investigation of interactions between humans, and he used those interactions as building blocks or stepping stones to a vast spiritual view. For example, if two people were arguing about valuable tool, versus a less, valuable tool, what does that, say about people's interactions with their bodies and their minds, with their families, with their, social group, with, nature, with the spiritual universe? And it, was quite appealing to me also as a psychiatrist, because in my everyday practice, you are working with really nitty-gritty stuff, and you try to expand the closed-minded kind of narrow view that people have of their relationships and what's possible in them, to a more spacious one, so you're kind of building up from the from the bottom up, as it were, in an understanding of spirituality, like you work it out with your spouse, and then when you work it out with your spouse, you can work it out with your parents. Then when you work it out with your parents, you can work it out with your kids, and then your friends, and so on. As opposed to I'm enlightened and everything is one, and there's no difference between me and you, and everything's cool. So that just didn't, that in, working with, psychiatric patients, never worked out. You have to start with where people are at. And the spiritual approach of, Bonder's work in the Kabbalah of Envy was, that kind of a model. And it kind of ended up in a, in a hugely expansive, panorama. So I, then thought, well, what are his, sources? I'm always interested in, the original sources of good ideas. And, there were the Bible. Well, there were the Talmud, but, the Talmud's just way too complicated for me. And, Kabbalah, the Zohar, which is way too complicated for me. So I was thinking, what's the, simplest way I can get at, this information? And, that turned out to be the Hebrew Bible, the 24 books of the text. So then I started, to read the Bible. In Hebrew, in English, I brushed up on my Hebrew Bible, started going online, moved back to New Mexico from Port Townsend, joined a Jewish study group in Taos, where I lived for 10 years, and I just kind of became entranced and enchanted with the material in the Bible for a couple of reasons. One, it was a source of spiritual succor after I'd been given the boot by my Zen community, which had been that source for over 2 decades. And the other was that I was in it was pleasurable to re-encounter the spiritual tradition of of my childhood, of my race, but also finally I was beginning to get an inkling of a model of spirituality which comported with the reports of my DMT volunteers, which was the prophetic state, which was similar or more similar to reports of my volunteers than were the Eastern religious models or even the shamanic models, and so that then led me to start developing the theories which I present and write about in my book The Soul of Prophecy.
So I'll ask again then, I'm interested to know if you feel that the Bible is actually a historical record, or if you would agree with me that it's a series of sacred stories and myths.
Well, I think that it's somewhere in between. I don't think it's really possible to establish that there was a figure Abraham, one figure Abraham who was married to Sarah, his nephew was Lot, who moved to to Sodom. I don't think we'll ever be able to to establish that there that there were historical figures like that. And even going back, like were there two primordial humans, Adam and Eve, who had 3 sons, from whom the rest of humanity sprouted, as it were. I'm also, well, or on the other hand though, I think when you use the word myth, that kind of implies a completely imaginary, non-real, level of historicity, that it's just, made up in a way as an explanation for, various things, that you see in the natural world or the moral world. So I like to, think of the stories in the Bible as if they were true. Kind of like I approach the DMT reports. If I, looked at them as completely real, I would, get into some trouble. If I looked at them as completely imaginary, I would get into trouble. So I approached them as if, they were real. And then that allowed me the scaffolding to, drill into the experiences. Like, if this is real, what the DMT, volunteer is experiencing, like, being, then what's that being like? What are they telling the person? What is, the relationship between the being and the volunteer? What, do they look like? Where do they come from? Who do they pray to? Can you ask that being questions? So if you begin to treat them as real, then that opens up a whole alternate level of reality that then you can explore at great length and at great, depth. So it's kind of a, cognitive straddling. I don't truly believe that there was two humans, Adam and Eve. Adam was, born, and Eve was, pulled out of his, rib cage. But I treat the story as if it were real. In other words, okay, if there were an Adam and Eve, what were they like? What did they think? What was their relationship like with God? What did they do in the Garden of Eden? Where was the Garden of Eden? What were the plants there? What was the geography? Why did they hide from God after they ate from the tree? What was the tree? What was the snake? Was that, if you really look carefully at the text, you're exposed to and provided access to this vast world of narrative. For example, in the story of, Adam and Eve and the snake, God curses the snake and says, you will be slithering on the ground and you will be eating dust. Okay, which means, was the snake not slithering on the ground first? Was, did the snake stand? Did it have legs? If so, that's an interesting, kind of idea, kind of a, fact, as it were, to explore. And, God, tells the snake that it's going to hiss as opposed to speak, which, obviously, meant, that the snake once upon a time could speak, and it would be eating dust. Well, what did it eat before? So you can start to understand, the nature of the natural, world in a way that wasn't available to you before. You could look at human nature in a way that wasn't available before. And by microscopically, looking at the interactions described in the text, you're then able to branch upward and look at how those interactions describe increasingly complex and expansive kinds of relationships that extend through time, through space, through generations, through history. And I think the most important thing, which you touched upon, is the whole issue of the nature and the existence of God. You really aren't able to, read the Hebrew Bible without encountering its description, its, notion of God. Like, Bereshit bara. In the third word in the Hebrew Bible is God, Elohim. In the beginning of God creating, the heavens and the earth. And, for most, secular educated Westerners, that's enough to stop them in their tracks. They say, forget it. And they close the book and, that's it. Who is, God who made the heavens and the earth? But if you can stick, with it, which is, one of the important things that I learned, from, my Buddhist, practice is, if you can't understand, something, if encountering, something makes you anxious or is, cognitively impossible, to grasp, then just, carry on, just, continue and, see what happens. So, that was, kind of the approach, that I took. And I also, started to learn, biblical Hebrew. And I also, turned, to the medieval commentators. Really, it's impossible to understand the Bible without the aid of the medieval commentators. Because, they explain every word. They explain where those words come from. They explain the relationship of the first appearance of those words, to later appearances of those words. They, put the whole stories in context. They, deal with your anxiety, they deal with your confusion. So they're kind of like the sitters. They kind of say, the Bible is pretty weird, but here's what it really means. And, don't be afraid. It's all going to work out at, some point. So there's a, number of, medieval commentators, like half a dozen, And you know, all of their commentaries have been translated into English. And you just, you have them open side by side, like the first verse in the first verse in the Bible is, "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth." And if you open any commentary, there's page after page after page of describing what that means. And so after you've read one sentence and you've read like 100 pages explicating what that one sentence means, then you can go on to the next sentence in the text. So it isn't for the faint of heart. It isn't for the impatient. You have to be able to to knuckle down if you're going to be entering in to the world of the Hebrew Bible. And there are a number of issues that cause resistance. One of them is the notion of God, which we can talk about.
In your Tyringham lecture, you mentioned that studying the Bible intensely can lead to altered states. And I presume that you perhaps you've experienced something like that. And I was wondering if you could describe that altered state that one can enter through intensely studying the Bible.
Well, it's true. I mean, that's been my experience, is that intense study leads to an altered state. And I think that state evolves with time. especially as your understanding of the text matures. There's a couple of ways of studying the Bible. I think the most useful way, especially in the beginning when you're really traversing terra incognita, is to read it out loud. To read it in English out loud. So you can hear yourself, you can hear your words. And you can learn it, I think, a little more quickly. You can also begin to, visualize what's being described if you hear yourself speaking those words. If you can learn, biblical Hebrew, and you can, read the biblical Hebrew out loud as well, I think that adds a whole, another level, to the auditory, aesthetic, somatic and emotional, somatic effects of study. Because well, because Hebrew is an amazing language. It isn't that hard to learn, and only it simple letters, and there are not that many letters. So once you start to hear the sound of the Hebrew language, of the verses, the rhythm, the accents, the intonation. And then you start combining your understanding of the English, translation of the Hebrew with your reading of the Hebrew. And you're going back and forth. So I've read the Torah, the first five books of the Hebrew Bible, probably 15 times or so now. You go through it once a year on an annual cycle. And like after the 10th time or the 12th time or the third time, you start understanding it better, or you start discovering things that you really hadn't noticed the 10th time. You might notice the 12th time that you read it. So you can you can let your mind wander too, the more and more you're familiar with the text, because you, in a way, start to expect the next word, or you're increasingly familiar with phrases or narratives or scenes or encounters, and you're able to you know, to put yourself in that world, you know, Joseph being thrown into the pit, you know, by his older brothers, you know, like, what was that, you know, pit like? How big was it? How dark was it? What time of day was it? How frightened was Joseph? What were his, you know, brothers thinking, feeling, doing at the time? You know, why did they do it? You know, so as you're, you know, kind of reading automatically after a certain number of years, you're able to kind of enter in, you know, to the world that's being described there. And I think once you're entering into the world being described there, you begin to, you know, tap in to the state of mind out of which emerged that text, which is a prophetic state. It's a, you know, mild prophetic state, albeit, but if you, you know, think about, you know, the text as written about prophetic experience, which is any spiritual state described in the text, which means encounters with, you know, God, any inspiration, any visions or any voices, even history. You know, Josephus, you know, believes that only a true, you know, prophet can, you know, can accurately, you know, retell history. You know, so even, you know, the, you know, boring historical, you know, genealogies, according to, you know, Josephus anyway, you know, those can only be, you know, detailed, you know, by a, you know, prophet. You know, so the entire text is a prophetic text. And once you become, you know, familiar with the text, once the text, you know, begins, you know, to resonate in you and you in it, you start to enter into the state out of which that text emerged. So I think it, you know, gives you a scent or a flavor or a, you know, mild, you know, taste of the state, you know, the prophetic state.
The evidence for theoneurology might appear to a critic to be anecdotal. And in science and in the realm of science, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. Do you think it's going to be possible, will it ever become possible, to present scientifically verifiable evidence for the existence of the DMT beings or the existence of God?
Well, yeah, you know, there are, I guess, you know, currently, or, yeah, well, the current, you know, model for understanding, you know, the biology or the you know, factual, the objective nature of spiritual experience is what I, you know, refer to as, you know, the bottom-up, you know, model, you know, neurotheology, which, you know, posits, you know, that the, you know, that the brain experiences a, you know, reflex as a result of certain stimuli, and those stimuli in, you know, the, you know, setting of, you know, neurotheology are, you know, things like prayer, you know, meditation, you know, fasting, chanting, which then, you know, kind of activate a, you know, reflex in the brain, which has, you know, certain, you know, features which are, you know, then after the fact, you know, described as spiritual, exaltation, you know, visions, you know, voices, out of body states, those kinds of things. And, you know, that is, you know, the reigning paradigm, you know, for understanding, you know, the biology of spirituality. You know, so as a, you know, counterpoint to that, you know, based on my studies, I've, you know, developed a, you know, a, you know, model which is kind of a, you know, top-down model, you know, theoneurology, which, you know, proposes that, you know, God, you know, designed the brain in, you know, such a way as to provide communication with us. And you know, DMT, you know, could, you know, possibly, you know, serve as a, you know, mediator for certain, you know, features of spiritual experience, in, you know, particular, the, well, the phenomenological, you know, contents of spiritual experience, you know, the visions and the voices. You know, so it isn't, you know, meant, you know, to replace, you know, the bottom up. Well, the bottom up, you know, model. It's, you know, more intended to kind of, you know, counterbalance it. You know, provide a, you know, theological perspective, a, you know, higher level of organization and abstraction. It can explain why the brain is configured that way. You know, from a spiritual point of view, you know, rather than an evolutionary point of view. You know, so I think it, you know, provides a you know, host of, you know, potential answers, which kind of interface in the brain, in the mind of, you know, those experiencing spiritual states from a more abstract, you know, perspective, a more, you know, like a, you know, top-down approach, you know, rather than a, you know, purely neuronal, you know, kind of model. It's, you know, more of a, you know, godly model, as it were. And, you know, whether or not we can establish the, you know, validity or, you know, the, you know, factual, the objective nature of, you know, the DMT beings or of God, I, you know, suppose that, you know, it, you know, might be possible at some point in the future to develop a dark matter camera, for example, and you could, you know, and you might be able to, you know, photograph the, you know, contents of dark matter, including, you know, the inhabitants. You know, so, you know, theoretically, it, you know, may be, you know, that at, you know, some point we're able to take, you know, pictures of what's in dark matter or, you know, dark energy, and, you know, then, you know, compare those images to what, you know, people, you know, describe in the DMT state, and, you know, to the extent, you know, that they resemble each other, you know, I suppose, you know, that could be some, you know, verification of, you know, their objective nature. It also, you know, may be, though, that, you know, the only place we're able to actually apprehend those, you know, things is in our mind, that it requires a, you know, consciousness interface. And, you know, no camera will be able to take, you know, pictures of things which require human consciousness in order to apprehend. You know, so it, you know, may turn out, you know, not to be the case that we can develop a dark matter camera. But, you know, we ought to try and, you know, see where it leads. I think with respect to being able to, you know, prove the existence of God, you know, I think that's all, I think that's always going to be indirect proof. Yeah, I don't think we'll ever be able to really take a picture of, you know, God, or, you know, measure God's, you know, height, or, you know, contents or constituents. You know, it, you can look all around you, you know, for evidence of, you know, God's existence, and, you know, the regularity of nature, or the, or, you know, the irregularities in nature, you know, the human mind, you know, the human soul, which you can only, you know, tell through its activities, you know, rather than actually, you know, being able to measure it. You know, so all of those, you know, things are, you know, are, I guess, what you would call, you know, not, you know, direct proof, but, you know, more indirect. Well, you know, one of my, you know, patients and I were, you know, talking a long time ago, and, you know, she asked me, "Well, do you believe in God?" And I said, you know, and I replied, "Well, you know, how can you not? You know, just look around. You know, there is, you know, something rather than nothing, and that, you know, something has a certain, you know, configuration which leads people to, you know, believe in, you know, the existence of God. You know, the natural world is so, is, you know, so beautiful. You know, what for? Well, one explanation is, you know, the natural world is so beautiful because it inspires in us a, you know, feeling of awe and of reverence, which then, you know, taken upward to, you know, who created things, or who created nature in, you know, such a way. Yeah, you know, so you ultimately end up at the same point. You know, one of my, you know, favorite, you know, commentators is a Spaniard named Abraham Ibn Ezra, who lived between 1000 and 1100 AD. And, one of his, sayings is that all of the sciences ultimately, lead to God. You know, like if you look at all these, sciences, it's the God particle, it's the God molecule, it's the God gene, it's, the God equation. All of these, disciplines are ultimately, seeking the ultimate, source of the matter at hand. Mathematics, chemistry, physics, biology. I don't think that's a coincidence. I think it's a description of, the nature of the, phenomena, that we're dealing with, that we're all, kind of interested in the, source of things as they are, and what maintains things as they are in their particular configuration. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of how I ended up believing in the existence of God, is by tracing it backwards, as it were. Like, if things are the way they are, why is that the case? And there has to be some beginning and some, some creator of things. And, that's implied in, the Big Bang. Before the Big Bang, what was in existence? Well, nothing. Well, I mean, that is true from a, cognitive point of view. Like, we, aren't able to comprehend things, before the Big Bang. There's no time, there's no space, there's no matter, and we aren't able to comprehend those kinds of notions. But there obviously was something before the Big Bang, but it's completely incomprehensible, and that thing which is completely incomprehensible is God. But God, in a way, created the comprehensible, which is, contained in God, but isn't really, God itself, but we can impute or we can infer, God's existence from observing what's around us and what's inside of us, too. If that makes sense.
I'd like to continue along with the notion that these DMT beings are a real phenomenon, and I know that many DMT users report encountering a being which is known as Mother Ayahuasca, which seems to be forgiving and reassuring and coaxing and healing. And some others come back talking about having encountered something quite the opposite of that, which is like the trickster, and something that makes you feel terrified and brings up all your worst feelings. Can you comment on the nature of the DMT beings and their function, if you like? I heard you speak about the world to come and the biology of the rapture.
I think there's a number of ways to, conceptualize, the DMT beings. I think what they at, bottom represent, or what, they are, is, they represent things that were normally invisible or were previously invisible. So you could kind of present a spectrum. They could be inhabitants of other planets. They could be repressed, conflicts in our own mind, or visual, or concretized images of introspected important people in our lives, our parents, our friends. Doctors, priests, that kind of thing, that they're, kind of representatives or a, visualization of our ideas about certain people. You know, they could be, you know, healing, or well, they could be, you know, forces which are engarbed with, you know, perceptual constituents, you know, visual and auditory ones. So I think there's any number of ways of, you know, looking at them, you know, from, you know, being completely objective to being completely subjective. You know, products of our own mind, you know, versus externally perceived or externally existent things. You know, if we're going to, you know, look at them as externally existent things, you could, you know, look at them as, you know, being entities themselves, or they could be, you know, individualized manifestations of more universal, you know, forces like hate or love or healing or wisdom. In which case, you could, you know, look at them as angels, at least from the point of view of the Bible. You know, there are, you know, there are healing angels. You know, Raphael is the healing angel. You know, the Hebrew word for healing is Rapha. And, you know, and one of the, you know, and one of the words for God is El, you know, so Raphael, the healing God, or, you know, God is my healer. And, you know, there's, you know, Gabriel, who's the angel of might, you know, Geber is a, you know, warrior. Yeah, you know, so you could look at ayahuasca or the spirit of ayahuasca as a mediator between, you know, God and you. And that, you know, mediator is what the, you know, Bible, you know, refers to as an angel. You know, so I think where people get, you know, hung up, at least from, you know, my point of view, is the shamanic model, it kind of stops with the spirits. It kind of stops with the angels. And the spirit of ayahuasca is prayed to and is, you know, worshipped, is, you know, deified in a way. And one, you know, thing that the Bible is always, you know, pointing out is that the angels are only intermediaries between God and humans, because, you know, God is, you know, normally incomprehensible, invisible. You know, and I think one of the, you know, drawbacks of, you know, the shamanic model is it isn't you know, God-oriented. It stops with, you know, God's angels, which I think in the case of ayahuasca is, you know, Raphael, and is, you know, healing guys, or, you know, the healing, you know, modality. You know, so if you're, you know, praying to ayahuasca, you know, I think it would be more cogent or more accurate or more, you know, salient if you were kind of interested in, you know, taking it, you know, to the highest, you know, possible level, is to pray to God to, you know, send ayahuasca, you know, to you, to help you. You're not, you know, you're not actually, you know, praying, you know, to ayahuasca, but you're praying to God to work through ayahuasca. You know, so there is a, you know, subtle, you know, distinction, I think, between those two ways of, you know, looking at the healing process. When it, you know, comes to, you know, visualizing these intermediaries. And, you know, angels are not all good. You know, there's demons if you're going to be, you know, looking at a cosmology or a, you know, hierarchy of angels or of, you know, mediators. You know, Satan is an angelic figure, an incorporeal spiritual entity with certain, you know, properties, has, you know, certain effects on humans and the natural world. You know, so it is important to be able to distinguish between, you know, good intermediaries and, you know, bad intermediaries, you know, good angels and, you know, bad angels, as it were. And, you know, that's one of the, you know, boons of, you know, the Hebrew Bible, is that it, you know, teaches you, you know, how to interact with these angels, you know, how to determine if they're good or they're bad. Like, you know, for example, you know, there's an encounter in the book of, you know, Joshua, between, you know, Joshua and an angel. You know, there's an angel who's, you know, standing with a sword, and you know, Joshua is uncertain. Is, you know, this a good angel or is it a bad angel? And you know, so Joshua says, "Are you, you know, for us or are you against us?" And you know, if you're in an ayahuasca state and you're not, you know, sure if the entity or the being that you're in, you know, encountering is, you know, good or bad, you could ask it, or you can tell, you know, by its appearance if it's good or bad. You know, so you can learn some, you know, tricks of the trade, as it were, from, you know, learning about the interactions of the, you know, prophetic, you know, figures in, you know, the text of the Bible when you're entering into states that have, you know, prophecy like, you know, characteristics, and in, you know, particular, you know, interacting with the intermediaries that you might encounter.
I think it's interesting what you were talking about earlier, prolonging the DMT experience in order to perhaps give people a chance to sort of map out and learn to explore the areas that they find themselves in, and I think quite possibly you're right that knowledge of the Hebrew Bible might indeed be instructive for those types of experiences. I want to put it to you that maybe the creator of reality is kind of needs to be stopped. There's a lot of strife and misery, and some people might say that it's kind of wrong to create that. Does God need to be brought to justice or stopped?
Well, you know, that's a, you know, funny question. Well, you know, the rabbis, you know, debated that issue. You know, the Talmudic rabbis, you know, they, you know, there was a debate, you know, between the two schools. You know, one of one group and one of the other group. You know, one of the schools was a little more harsh, you know, kind of like Rinzai Zen, and you know, the other was a little more, you know, gentle, like, you know, Soto Zen, and you know, they were, you know, and you know, they were debating whether or not, you know, man should have been created. You know, should man have been created? And you know, they look at the world and what a mess, you know, man has, you know, made of the world, and they, you know, conclude that it would have been better if man had not been created. You know, they just, you know, looked at the facts. You know, they looked at the data, and they said, yeah, it would have been better if man had never been created. But they said, you know, regardless, man has been created, so we need to do the best we can as humans. You know, we didn't really, you know, have a, you know, say in, you know, God's decision. So that kind of addresses at least a anthropological or excuse me. Yeah, I mean, you know, that kind of answers the question, you know, from a human-centric point of view, which I think our only way of addressing it. You know, whether, you know, God should be stopped, I mean, you know, that kind of implies that, you know, God is, you know, exists and is operating. But those, you know, concepts are, you know, are really not germane or, you know, relevant. You know, they're in a way close approximations to what, you know, God is doing. But if you, you know, think about, you know, God as existing before, you know, time and space, if you think about, you know, God as, you know, knowing all, you know, possible future outcomes and everything which has, you know, transpired in the past and is transpiring now, there's really, you know, no you know, there just isn't any, there isn't any way to make God correspond to our notions of reality as viewed through the lens of the human mind. You know, so to have God stop, I mean, if God stopped existing, I mean, you know, that's impossible. And, you know, for God, you know, to exist means, you know, for God to act. We are experiencing, you know, God's, you know, providence, you know, the manifestation of, you know, God in the, you know, phenomenal world. You know, so I suppose if it was even, you know, possible to think about God stopping, that would mean everything else would stop and we would be, you know, before the Big Bang. But it's, you know, taught that, you know, God existed, you know, before the Big Bang and will exist after the Big Crunch, which kind of, you know, begs the issue about what does exist mean when it comes to God. So, I mean, it gets to be pretty, it gets to be kind of a deep rabbit hole that we can explore, but I don't think we can ever really conclude much. Well, you know, there's the issue about, you know, why, you know, good people suffer and why evil people flourish. You know, that's called, you know, theodicy, you know, the justification of God. You know, how can you, like, how can you, justify, God if, the world is, so unfair? And obviously the most important story in that regard is the story of Job. You know, Job was made to, suffer needlessly, or, so it seemed. And there are a number of answers to the question of theodicy. You know, why, the righteous, suffer and, the evil seem to flourish. And, I think it kind of ultimately, boils, down, to the fact that, God's ways aren't our ways and God's thoughts aren't our thoughts, as the prophet in Isaiah states. I mean, we can, we can attempt to understand, why that's the case, but ultimately, it's us trying to comprehend an incomprehensible, being and its ways and its thoughts.
Are you familiar with the turtles all the way down concept of sort of nested simulations?
Not really, no. What is it?
So I think it derives from a idea that all of reality is riding on the back of an enormous space turtle. And then what's that space turtle riding? Another larger space turtle, and it's just turtles all the way down. And it's an idea of that lends itself to the notion that reality is a simulation, and that it's the genesis of that simulation is another simulation, and it's kind of simulations all the way down. And using that just momentarily as a kind of a model for the DMT beings and the DMT experiences, it could be perhaps that it's like in the film The Matrix, where beings that you encounter are either programs or subroutines. Certainly in the world of cryptocurrency, which is digital, it's tokens resulting from a mathematical protocol, elliptic curve cryptography, in fact. The mathematical protocol was designed to encapsulate these coins and make them impossible to replicate, so that when you have human beings which are unique in nature, perhaps these beings could be the cryptographic seal, if you like, in a simulation, which is there to, like you say, You term it as being an intermediary between the in the Hebrew Bible model, it's God, and in this nested simulation idea, it would be the next shell of simulation. So perhaps they're there more to act as a barrier, and I'm interested to know if any of your research lends itself to that notion, that perhaps instead of an intermediary, they're more there as a barricade, the DMT beings.
Well, yeah, I think in both, you know, cases, it's, you know, seen like an interface, I suppose, between us and, you know, something, you know, that is out there, you know, that isn't us. It's, you know, some kind of interface, some kind of interaction. Well, you know, it's interesting. I'm not sure if we touched upon this last week, but, you know, there's a couple of elements regarding the properties of DMT that I think would qualify it as the endomatrix, as it were. You know, DMT is transported into the brain using energy across the blood-brain barrier, and the brain only does that with respect to necessary components like sugar, amino acids, that it's not able to make on its own. You know, so it's as if the, you know, brain requires DMT for normal function, which is a strange concept. I mean, also within the last few years, it's been discovered that the DMT synthesizing apparatus is active in the retina. You know, so it, you know, could be that, you know, DMT is the endomatrix. It is the interface which is, you know, kind of responsible, you know, for our encounter with what we call, you know, consensus reality. And, you know, the interface of the outside world, you know, versus our minds. But, you know, in you know, some ways that, you know, it still begs the question, like, if this everyday, you know, world is some kind of DMT hallucination, you know, would we act any differently? You know, would we still have, you know, moral responsibility, you know, for our behavior? You know, would the golden rule still hold? You know, would we still experience, you know, consequences, you know, of our actions? You know, so I think in, you know, the movie The Matrix, you know, there's only one, you know, layer. There's the blue pill and the red pill. But I think it could, you know, like you were describing, it could be turtles all the way down. You know, but I, you know, tend to believe that everything, well, I guess, you know, one of the, you know, things that I learned from Buddhism is, you know, that the law of karma is, you know, cause and effect. Everything which is now is a result of what preceded it, and everything in the future is the result of what's going on now. And, you know, one of the, you know, things which, you know, puzzled me was this, you know, notion that, you know, the law of, you know, cause and effect stipulates that everything has a beginning and a middle and an end. Everything arises, exists, and then, you know, passes away. But you know, that began me, you know, wondering, well, is, you know, that the case with the law of cause and effect too? Like, you know, does the, you know, law of, you know, cause and effect have a beginning, exist, and then end? And, you know, that was one of the, you know, ways I got a, you know, toehold on, you know, God or the first cause or the ultimate cause in Aristotle's thinking, is that, you know, God created, you know, cause and effect and sustains cause and effect. And after, you know, cause and effect, you know, no longer are in operation, then, you know, God will continue to exist. But you have to put exist in quotes. You know, so I think even with this, you know, you know, turtles all the way down. You are at, you know, some point, you know, faced with, you know, deciding if, you know, there is anything co-eternal with God. You know, like the first turtle, was that co-eternal with God? Or is, you know, God, which is described as, you know, one, unique, you know, well, did God exist, you know, before, you know, primordial matter, or in this case, the first turtle? You know, so I think at a certain point you have to decide, you know, what it's going to be in your mind, and then, you know, take it from there. You know, like, well, like Aristotle, for example, believed that there was, you know, God that was co-eternal with primordial matter. You know, that matter always existed and that God always existed. And at a certain point, you know, God started working with primordial matter. You know, Maimonides, you know, said, you know, if you believe the Hebrew Bible, that, you know, God is one, then, you know, that means God is unique and there wasn't anything co-eternal with God. You know, Maimonides was a smart guy and, you know, kind of presents, you know, the pros and cons for, you know, something be, you know, being, you know, co-eternal with God versus, you know, God, you know, being only the, you know, pre-existent thing. And, you know, like as a Jew, he, you know, kind of, you know, settled on the uniqueness of God. And then, you know, God, you know, then created the first, you know, turtle or, you know, primordial matter with which he worked to, you know, generate the present universe. But yeah, I think it's, you know, at this point, I think it's, you know, just a matter of opinion. I don't think we're really going to be able to establish, you know, the, you know, veracity of one view or the other for quite some time.
I guess we've been going for a couple of hours now. We're probably going to have to start winding this up pretty soon. I wanted to ask you one more question. Well, I have a few more questions if we have time, but one more question I wanted to definitely get in was that you mentioned to me that you have been reading a new paper that you feel is going to blow people's minds. Are you in a position to say anything more about it now, or is it under wraps for now?
Well, I would say it's mostly under wraps. Yeah, yeah. You know, it ought to come out probably within a few months. But I'll just leave it at that.
Okay, perhaps you might be able to make an announcement on your YouTube channel or something like that, so that or probably it will become public knowledge anyway. It will be in the public eye, so to speak.
Right. I think it'll be coming out probably, you know, early next year.
So, thank you so much again for your time and for speaking on these subjects, which can be so controversial and so difficult to talk on. I really want to thank you for that.
Well, sure. Oh, you're welcome. I'm glad you asked those questions because, you know, they're very thorny and very hard to articulate. So the more we talk about them, I think, you know, the better for everybody.
Indeed. DMT and the Soul of Prophecy, this is Dr. Strassman's most recent book. For anyone who hasn't read it, who's been interested by the conversation we've had, get yourself a copy of this book. It's fascinating. I guess we'll leave it there. See you next time.
Okay, good. Okay, great. Okay, bye-bye. Thanks.